Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures.
And I reluctantly did. Well, the physician's assistant, she listened to my lungs, you know, breathing and out. She has this worried look on her face. She goes, gets the doctor, he does the same thing. They look at each other, they look at me, and they say, you have serious heart disease. So to make a long story short, I had heart surgery in 2005. I'm still alive. So.
And riding his bike, how many miles a day?
Last 30 years, probably 40,000 miles.
40,000 miles. And the last 10 years since you had the operation, it's a good fraction. 2,000 miles a year. Thank you, Lord. All right. Okay, Ethel. Ethel said she might be able to get through this without crying, but we'll see.
It's hard to put on my serious face because you often see me being funny, but this is very serious. And pardon my voice, I'm just getting over whatever it is I had, past tense. When I was thinking about what am I thankful for, I mean, I could just talk for hours, but we don't have hours. There's one really big thing in my life that I'm the most thankful for. And through no choice of my own, I became a single parent back in 1985. And I had three small children. It was very, very difficult. And I had never really lived alone before. And I mean, as an adult without other adults around. And it was overwhelming and frightening and scary. And I was living in the Buffalo area at the time. And God provided wonderful people that would just pray for me, pray with me. If I woke up at midnight crying, there was someone I could call who would pray with me and encourage me. And I mean, God was so good to me in this time of my life because the children and I never lacked for anything. We had food, we had shelter, we had, you know, clothing, everything we needed we had. And then the most amazing thing of all was that he provided a godly man who loved my children first, then me. And not just any man, but a man who had never even had a girlfriend before. A man who wasn't raised Jewish, but knew Hebrew better than I did. And our family had been broken, but then it became whole. And that was a long time ago. I married Daniel Chadwick in 1988. And he's raised my children as his own and even adopted them. And that is really what I thank God for the most.
Well, the third testimony is from Miriam Gerardo, who I'll just read it. She wrote this back to me. I will be traveling back to Rochester tomorrow, so I will miss the service. But I do want to testify about how the Lord has protected and guided me this past year. So this is her story. I had determined that when the time came when my grandmother would pass away, that I would take an entire week off from work to take care and help out my family. On my first day back to work after the week, I got the news that my position had been eliminated. I felt peace that God was at work, and this was in his timing. He released me from that place with a very generous severance package that provided for my needs. My desire was to be working by September, and after 5 months out of work, I started my new position on exactly August 31st. The new position is a lot closer to home and allows me to work remotely some days. He's granted me a lot of favor, but most of all, a sense that he's always in control. I was able to not only rest and recover from losing my grandmother, but also help others with my time off. He has never forsaken me, and for that I am filled with joy and gratitude. Last line, thanks to the congregation for their love and support during this challenging time. So thank all of you. And our eyes to receive it today, and we pray that you would make us not just hearers of your word, but doers. In Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. So I've got a little rabbi story here that I think you'll enjoy as we get started. Once there was a rabbi who let his dog out to relieve himself late one night. He watched some TV and then remembered to let the dog back in. And when he opened the door, he was shocked at what he saw. In his dog's mouth was his neighbor's rabbit. Pet rabbit, dead. Bad dog, said the panicked rabbi. He took the rabbit away and looked at it. He couldn't bring himself to tell his neighbor what had happened, so he decided to clean it up and leave it on his neighbor's porch. He took the rabbit into the bathroom, washed off all the blood and the dirt. It took him forever. He had to wash it four times to get it all cleaned. He brushed its beautiful white fur as he blow-dried it, and since it was so dark, he snuck into the neighbor's yard and laid the rabbit down on the porch in front of the door. The next day, he was on his way to the car to go to work, and his neighbor was outside. Hi, he said. Hi, replied the rabbi, a little bit nervous. And his neighbor said, something weird happened last night. Oh, really? What's that? Asked the rabbi, sweating now. Well, our rabbit died yesterday, and we buried him. And this morning, he was lying on my front porch. Now, if you are in my family, we actually had a dog that would do that. Except he would do it with woodchucks, not pets. Well, he did it with some pets, too, but he'd do it with woodchucks. And he would deposit the woodchuck on the step of our neighbor's front step after he dug it up from being buried. So that story really spoke to my heart. So we're gonna go back to the Parsha this week, and it's kind of interesting for those of you who've been with us for a while. The Holy Spirit directed me to go into the book of Joshua, which is not on this scroll, and right about the same time we got this thing, this beautiful cabinet, and so we haven't really used it that much because we've been going through the book of Joshua. But I felt it was a time we kind of got to the end of the book of Joshua to get back to the Parsha. And this week's Parsha is got lots of stuff in it that I've taught upon before. But I was led just very, very clearly to go to a part that I've avoided before. And maybe you don't like reading it. It's about the story of Dinah, which is not a happy story. But at the end of the story, I just was struck by something, and we'll get to that. So let me give you a little bit of background here. This is a story about Jacob. And as a young man, he cheated his brother Esau out of his birthright and his father's blessing. And Esau was overheard afterwards saying he was going to murder Jacob. So Jacob had to flee from his family in fear that his brother would kill him. And God blessed Jacob's time away from his family, although he still went through many trials, and after about 20 years, he ended up with four wives, 11 sons and a daughter, and lots of flocks and herds. He had prospered greatly. And then God appeared to him in a dream and said this in Genesis 31, I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed a memorial stone, where you made a vow to me. Get up now and leave this land and return to the land of your relatives. So this place, Bethel, was where Jacob had seen the ladder or the stairway from heaven come down, and God had appeared to him. So Jacob returned to the land of his family, but he was in great fear that Esau would still be angry at him and attack him and destroy he and his family. So when he got near to where Esau lived, he sent messengers with lavish gifts to Esau to tell him he was coming. And he spent the night before Esau holding on to God. Now, some of you might know this story as wrestling with God, but I want to encourage you to check out one of the things that the Lord showed me in a teaching called Holding On to God about this, that he really wasn't wrestling with him. He was hanging on to his feet. and not letting go until God would bless him. So he spent this night praying before Esau, and he was praying for protection in the coming encounter. And when he came near to Esau, here's what we read in chapter 33, verse 4. But Esau ran to meet him, hugged him, fell on his neck, and kissed him, and they wept. Wow. This was a supernatural, miraculous change in Esau's heart. Clearly a miracle from the Lord. And just try to imagine how thankful Jacob would have been. It had been 20 years since he had fled away from his brother, expecting that he would kill him. So Jacob and Esau went their own ways because, according to Genesis 36, they had such large flocks that they couldn't stay together, so they separated. And Jacob had many other trials. Earlier, there was contention among his wives. His one true love, Rachel, was barren for a long time. He was cheated out of his wages by Rachel's brother Laban. And when he hung on to God like that, the Lord touched his joint of his hip, and he put it out of joint. And so he limped now. But in Genesis 33, Jacob has moved on. And in verse 18, we read this. So Jacob arrived in Shalom, in peace, to the city of Shechem, which is in the land of Canaan, when he came from Paddan Aram and camped right in front of the city. In verse 19, he purchased the portion of the field where he had pitched his tent from the sons of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 pieces of money. There he set up an altar, and he called it El is Israel's God. Now, understand this, that in those days, when a person wanted to express their gratitude to God, the way that they did it, the main way that they did it, was by making a sacrifice, a thank offering. And in Leviticus chapter 7, verses 11 through 13, Moses instructed how to make these thank offerings. But there were also offerings for sin, for guilt, for atonement. But every offering that was made always had a component of thanksgiving along with it. So I understand this, and I hope you can see this too, that Jacob set up this altar at this place, a Shechem, to thank God for the miraculous deliverance that he and his family had experienced from his brother Esau's murderous wrath that had been there before. So far, everything has gone wonderfully in this episode of Jacob's life, and he's fulfilling the holiday that we're celebrating right now, Thanksgiving. But then another great trial happened to Jacob. Hamor had a son named Shechem. And it's a little bit confusing when you read it because the son's name is the same as the city. They're both named Shechem. Shechem, the son, raped Jacob's daughter Dinah and wanted to marry her. And Dinah's brothers were furious, and they deceitfully demanded that all the men of the city of Shechem be circumcised before they would agree to let Dinah marry this young man. And the men of the city agreed to do this. And then in chapter 34, verse 25, we read, then on the third day after their circumcision, while they were in pain, two of Jacob's sons, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, each took his sword and came against the city undisturbed and killed every male in the city. Now, this ability to come up with a very clever scheme, this ran in the family, if you're familiar with the family. And it actually was a confirmation of Jacob's name. His name, Jacob, means heel catcher, somebody who hides in the bushes and grabs your heel when you're walking by and to rob you or something, or deceiver. That was what his name meant. And remember, Jacob had schemed to steal his brother's birthright and his blessings. So his sons inherited that scheming ability. And also, if you know further on in Genesis, this is a precursor to that same later scheming when they did try to do away with their younger brother, Joseph. And they schemed and lied to their father and sold him into slavery. So all of this happened. And then verse 26, Hamor and his son Shechem, they killed with the sword, and they took Dinah from Shechem's house and left. And Jacob's sons came upon the slain and plundered the city because they defiled their sister. So Simeon and Levi had killed all the men of the city. And understand that there were four wives. So Dinah was the daughter of Leah. And Simeon and Levi were her full brothers. So they were particularly incensed about what had happened to her. But then the rest of the brothers got into it, and they plundered the rest of the city. So they approved of what had happened here. And maybe you're thinking, well, what about Joseph? He was such a righteous man. Would he have approved? Well, Joseph was just a child at this time. So it doesn't mention what Joseph thought about it. But it does mention what Jacob thought about it. Verse 30, Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "You've brought trouble on me, making me a stench among the inhabitants of the land, among the Canaanites and the Perizzites. I am but a few men. They'll gather against me and strike me, and then I'll be destroyed, my household and I." So what was Jacob's reaction to his son's actions? Obviously, he was horrified by what they had did, and he was also in great fear that the surrounding people who were friends with the people of the city would take vengeance upon him for this. So was this attack a just retribution for Dinah's rape? Well, you know, the Bible says, even before, or in the law of Moses, it says an eye for an eye, meaning the punishment should fit the crime. So killing all the men in an entire city because one of them had raped Dinah was certainly not an eye for an eye. So how did Jacob's sons react to their father's accusation that they made him a stench? Verse 31, but they said, "Should he treat our sister like a prostitute?" Obviously not repentant, not repentant at all, justifying their murder by blaming Shechem for what had happened here. So once again, as had happened really just a short time before where he was going to meet Esau, Jacob found himself in great fear for the safety of his family. But as I was studying this, I realized that this fear was different from the fear of Esau attacking him. You see, the attack that he was expecting from Esau, Jacob himself had caused that conflict that was there. He had cheated his brother out of his birthright and blessing, but the attack he expected now was due to his sons making him a stench among the neighbors of the Shechemites. And to appease Esau, Jacob had repented, apologized, given gifts, prayed to God that he would protect his family, that he would change Esau's heart. But Jacob's sons were still not willing to repent of this. So he couldn't expect God, the God of justice, to help him in this. You see the difference there? So Jacob still felt that way about Simeon and Levi, by the way, years later on his deathbed when he prophesied about their murderous attack. And he said, you know, he didn't prophesy good things about them because of this murderous attack. Now, if we think about this kind of dilemma, it was interesting to me. This is the same dilemma frequently faced by Moses. He was leading people who sinned and brought destruction on themselves. They made and worshipped an idol. They disobeyed God about the Sabbath. They grumbled and complained and finally refused to take the promised land. So in Moses' case also, God's judgment was not Moses' fault, just as it was not Jacob's fault, or unless you could say, well, you know, he should have taught his children better. But who knows? Maybe he did try to teach them. The judgment was due to the people whom Jacob was leading, not to Jacob. What can a leader do in a situation like that? Well, if you go back to the story of Moses, Moses executed the worst offenders when they made the golden calf. He pleaded with God for forgiveness for the others, and he offered himself as a sacrifice to pay their penalty. But Jacob's situation was really different. He wasn't about to punish his own sons by executing them. I don't think any man would ever consider doing that with his sons. And actually, this is similar to the problem that David had. If you've read the story of David and his sons Amnon and Absalom, Amnon raped his half-sister Tamar, and David failed to punish him at all. And because of that, Absalom, Tamar's full brother, murdered Amnon in revenge. And again, David couldn't bring himself to punish Absalom. He exiled him. And eventually, Absalom led a coup and almost took over David's kingdom. So it's a pattern. And I have to say, this is one of the things that that really was a learning experience for me as a rabbi, because I've experienced situations like this too. Some of the difficulties I've had in leaving this congregation have been due to my own sin, my own baggage, my own pride or fear or foolishness. But some had nothing to do with me. It's been other people's sin, other people's fear, other people's pride. And what I realized is that situations like this are part of the price that leaders sometimes have to pay. Now also, as I was praying about this, realized it's not just leaders who find themselves in dire straits, in great danger, due to no fault of their own. How many of you have experienced situations where you face loss, embarrassment, destruction, due to circumstances beyond your control? Anybody? Okay, well, it looks like about half the people. Some of you might be facing those circumstances right now. How do you deal with such a situation? The person whose fault it was has been confronted, but they won't repent. Repenting yourself doesn't help because it wasn't your fault. Well, there's an answer to that question as we go further in this story. So I'm going to read from the scroll, but let me first say that in order for God's plan to use Jacob's family to establish his kingdom, establish Israel, and eventually bring forth the Messiah, God had to intervene in this situation to guide Jacob in what to do. So I'm going to read to you now from Genesis chapter 35, and I'll translate it as I go along here. And we've got it up there in the Hebrew for those of you who are taking Hebrew with the vowels, so I hope you can follow. Vayomer Elohim al Yaakov, and the Lord spoke to Jacob, Kum ale Beit El, arise and go to Beit El, or as we would say, Bethel. Vashev Sham, and dwell there. Vaseh Sham Mizbecha, and make there an altar. Le'el Hanerei Alecha, an altar to the God who had appeared to you. Bevarachacha, when you were fleeing, Mipanei Esav Achicha, from the face of Esau, your brother. Vayomer Yaakov el Beito, and Yaakov said to his household, the El Kol Asher Imol, and all who were with him, Hasiru et Elohe Hanechar, get rid of your foreign gods, Asher Betochem, which are amongst you. Vahato Haru, and cleanse yourself. Vahalachfu simlotechem, and wash your clothes. Vanakuma, and arise. Vanaela, and go to Beit El, to Bethel. Vaasa sham, and I will make there. Nizbecha lael haona, and I will make there an altar to the God who answered me. Na bayom. Tsarati, in my day of distress, Vahiye imidi, and who has been with me, Baderek asher halichati, and all the way in which I have walked. So let's go back, and if the person on the slides there, Larry, you could go back to verse 1, because I'm going to kind of go through each verse here as we talk about this. God said to Jacob, get up and go to Bethel. Stay there and make an altar there to the God who appeared to you when you fled from your brother Esau. Now, what struck me as unusual in this, and I don't know if anybody else is struck by it, is that God is commanding Jacob here to build an altar. Now, Noah, Abraham, and Isaac, and Jacob later, or previously actually, had built altars, but they built them of their own volition, of their own decision. God had not commanded them to do it. This is the first time God commanded someone to build an altar. So I was just struck by that. And I began to ask in prayer, why, God? Why did you tell Jacob to build an altar at this time when he was in this great fear and distress? Why did you tell Jacob to go to Bethel? Remember, that was where Jacob had seen the stairway to heaven, and God had made a promise to him. And this is the promise. Back in Genesis chapter 28, go ahead, like four verses there. There you go. One slide, rather. Genesis 28:15. This is God at the top of the stairway to heaven speaking to Jacob about 20 years before. Behold, I am with you, and I will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, for I will not forsake you until I have done what I promised you. So that was the promise of Bethel to Jacob. God would protect Jacob wherever he went. And he would fulfill the promise. Well, what's the promise? The promise was to Jacob's father and grandfather, Abraham and Isaac, to give his family the land of Canaan, and to make his seed a blessing to all people. That is, to bring the Messiah through his family. Now, God knew Jacob needed to remember this promise so he could stand on it in his current distress. And Jacob had set up a pillar there at Bethel, and he poured oil on it and named the place Bethel, the house of God, but he hadn't built an altar there. So now back to Shechem. Jacob is in Shechem after the slaughter there of all the men. And back to Genesis 35, verse 2. So Jacob said to his household and to everyone who was with him, get rid of the foreign gods that are among you, cleanse yourselves, and change your clothes. So they were going to go to this altar to worship God. And he's commanding God to build the altar. And that caused Jacob to tell his family, get rid of your foreign gods. Cleanse yourself to meet with God. And I'm sure he was hoping that this would bring about the repentance of his sons, which had been laying heavily on his heart. He was hoping that by them having to come before God's altar, they would turn and repent. Verse 3. Now, let's go up to Bethel so that I can make an altar there to God, who answered me in the day of my distress and has been with me in the way I have gone. So God's command to Jacob was to build an altar, reminded him how God had answered him in his day of distress and said he would be with him in all the ways he went. That promise was not conditional. Do you understand that? It was not a conditional promise. If you obey me, it was just a promise of God. Now, Jacob had some past experience with God protecting him, and he had some faith that God will fulfill his promise by continuing to be with him, but it must have been really hard to have that faith when his sons had sinned so terribly now, and there was nothing he could do about it. But he purposed in his heart to obey God and go to Bethel and build the altar. And look at what happened. Verse 5. Then they journeyed, and the terror of God was on the cities that were around them, so they did not pursue Jacob's sons. And this is amazing. God came through for Jacob once again, supernaturally, putting his terror on all the friends of the Shechemites who should have attacked them in revenge before he even got to Bethel. On the way, all he did was purpose in his heart, okay, I'm going to obey what God said to do. I'm going to go to Bethel. So, what's the answer? Remember I said it would answer the question. What do we do when we're in a time of great distress and it's not even our fault? Even if it is our fault, we know what to do when it's our fault. Repent, right? Repent and beg for God to forgive you and to deal with the circumstances that you're in. But when it's not your fault, what do you do? And we learned the answer is right here. Worship God and continue to trust in his promises, even when you should be getting judgment because somebody else has caused it. But why did Jacob need to build an altar? He could have just worshipped God from his heart where he was. Well, we learned earlier that altars are used to make sacrifices. And I believe Jacob, it's not explicitly there, had to make two sacrifices on that altar. First, he needed to make a sacrifice on behalf of his sons, even though they were not repentant. And in the Bible, Job did something like this. If you remember the story of Job, where he would make sacrifices for his children because he knew they were off partying. And that has a really strong application to us, and I believe it's the application that the prayer group is going to start studying. Judith, you're going to get them to read that book, right? And the application is that we can make a sacrifice of prayer for people today. We don't have to build an altar. But we can make a sacrifice of prayer for the person that caused the problem we're in, that the Spirit of truth would reveal the truth to them about their actions, and for God's grace to bring conviction of sin, and for them to repent and receive God's forgiveness. And specifically that book that I was talking about talks about praying like that for people who don't know the Lord, that God would reveal to them the truth and that they would come to repentance and that judgment would not come upon them. So that, I believe, was the first offer. He was going to make an offering for his sons. And second, Jacob needed to make a thanksgiving sacrifice. And he purposed to make that sacrifice before he went to Bethel, just when he purposed to build the altar. And here's what we need to understand about that sacrifice, as it was in his mind. It was different from the one he made when God protected him from Esau. Jacob needed to thank God in faith for his divine protection, that he was still waiting to be fulfilled, that God would provide that protection in this present dangerous situation he was in, even though his family deserved judgment. Now, Jacob built that first altar at Shechem, and he gave a thanksgiving for something that God had already done. He delivered him from Esau. But here, after the incident with Dinah, Jacob was not in a thankful frame of mind. Instead, he was in great fear and distress. On his own, he would not have built an altar and sacrificed thanksgiving offerings because Dinah had been raped, his sons had committed murder, his family was in danger of being wiped out. So at this time, God had to intervene and tell Jacob, return to the place where you received my promise to you. Build an altar there before I fulfilled my promise to you. And believe that you will be miraculously delivered from this present danger. Why did God do this? God knew that Jacob needed something to enable him to get through, to endure this trial of fear he was going through at this time. God was planning to fulfill the promise he'd made to Jacob of Bethel. Remember, God said, I'll always be with you. I will always be with you. God would rescue him. But he was wanted Jacob to be thankful for it before he rescued him, which is a key thing. So Jacob purposed in his heart to build the commanded altar, cleanse his family, and they started traveling. And then as we read, that next slide, as they journeyed, the terror of God was on the cities around them, and they were protected. Even before they got to Bethel, God did this miracle. And he enabled Jacob's family to move forward. Now, this ties into the time of the calendar we are in, and also to what I talked about last week, that we all have a need to have an attitude of gratitude, to be thankful all the time, to be able to have God's peace in the midst of our hectic culture, not even this trouble we get ourselves into or other people get us into, but just the culture we're in. We need that peace. We need the peace of God, the shalom of God. And being in a thankful state of mind is the way to get to that place of peace in the midst of trials or in the midst of our hectic culture. It's frequently addressed in the Bible. Let me give you some example. We just talked about David's life and one of the tragedies that was there. But think of the other tragedies in David's life. The persecution by Saul, hiding in the wilderness, his friend Jonathan's death, his sin that he committed with Bathsheba, the death of their child, and then what we talked about, Amnon and Absalom and Tamar, and Absalom's rebellion. Yet, how many of you read the Psalms? How much thankfulness is in the Psalms of David? It's all through there. He's constantly thanking the Lord. The one that stuck to me was Psalm 136, if you want to go read it. It's the one that says, Hodu l'Adonai ki tov, give thanks to the Lord for his good, for his mercy we do us forever. And then it recites all the things that had gone on in that God had done in the history of the world. So we see that attitude of gratitude, even though David went through tragedies. And then Paul's life, Rabbi Sha'ul, opposition, beatings, betrayals, shipwrecks, false accusations, imprisonment, and eventually crucifixion. And he's the one who wrote this, Philippians 4. Rejoice in union with the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Don't worry about anything. On the contrary, make your requests known to God by prayer and petition. With what? Thanksgiving. How could he write that after going through all of those trials? Because he had this attitude of gratitude. So, why should we be thankful to God in the midst of our trials? There's a song that we sing. I just love the songs. It's not scripture, but I think it actually should be. Some of you remember, a thankful heart prepares a way for you, O Lord. Remember that song? A thankful heart prepares a way. It brings the presence of God. It enables us to persevere. And here's another part of this. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, everybody here is probably familiar with this verse, right? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of realities not seen. Well, here's what I saw in this, and this is something, if you just get one thing out of today, because I got this, being thankful for something in the future is the way you bring forth the substance of faith. I'll say it again. Being thankful for what God has promised for your future is the way you bring the substance of faith into that promise of God. Be thankful that God will keep his promises. That's how we manifest faith. Sometimes we can actually act on what God has promised us. But there's a lot of times you can't act on it. But you can be thankful and say, yes, Lord, I thank you that that's going to happen. You've promised it, and it is going to happen. So what should we be thankful for in the midst of trials? And I addressed this a little bit last week. Should we be thankful that we're suffering and pain, grieving, fearful, hopeless? No. You can't be thankful for those things. What we should be thankful for in the midst of our trials is that God will keep his promises. And specifically this promise in Romans 8. Furthermore, we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called in accordance with his purpose. In other words, he will redeem every situation that you or I, by our own foolishness, have gotten ourselves into or somebody else has gotten us into. So let's just pick apart this verse a little bit and look at the threads to it. Whose good does God promise everything will work together for? Your good. Can you say that? God promises for me, my good. Now, here's something very important to understand. What God's understanding of your good is may differ from what you think is good. But my experience, and I'm sure many of your experience, have shown that what he wants for you is always better than what you thought you wanted for yourself. He knows better because he can see the future. He is omniscient. So how do you qualify to have all things work together for your good? It says so in the verse. Everybody see it? Two things. Love the Lord and be called according to his purposes. Everybody see that? Okay. What does the Bible say is the evidence that you love him? Have an emotional reaction when you think about him? Sing lots of love songs to him? Those are good things to do, but look at what Yeshua says is the evidence that you love him. If you love me, let's read it together. You will keep my commands. Obedience. Obedience is the way you manifest the love of God in your life. That's how you make it real, by being obedient. Now, what does the Bible mean by being called according to his purposes? Well, the way I like to look at this is we are all called by this. Everybody who reads this is called. We're all called according to his purpose. We're all called by the written word of God to obey him and to take our promised land, which is what he plans for each of us. And if you remember, that is to become all he has destined us to become and to achieve all he has destined us to achieve. But here's the thing. Many are called and few are chosen. Who are the ones who are chosen? It's the ones who choose. The ones who choose to obey are the ones who are chosen. Everybody's called, everybody who reads the word, but it's only the ones who say, I obey, I will follow. So those who choose to obey the call of God in our lives, to obey him, pursue our promised land, we are the inheritors of the promise of all things working for our good. So how else can we be thankful in the midst of our trials? Well, we can do what Jacob did. We can meditate on the good things God has done in the past. Everything from the spiritual history of this world, like in Psalm 136, God did things from creation all the way up through going into the promised land. This is what we sing. You can meditate on what God has done in your spiritual history. Has he done anything for you? Well, he gave you life. It wasn't your entitlement. He gave you life. He gave you a body. He gave you strength. He gave you a brain, an incredible, this is the most, not just this one, but all of our brains, are the most complex things in the universe, our brains. He gave you revelation. He atoned for your sin by his sacrificial death. He brought you into the new covenant if you have received him. He's given you eternal life. He's adopted you as his child. He's come to live inside you in the form of the Holy Spirit. He's filled you to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. He's discipled you. He's revealed the truth to you in his word. He's delivered you from Satan's power over you. He's given you purpose. He's healed you. He's grown the fruits of the Spirit in your life. He's giving you a spiritual mishpacha, a family. He's prepared a dwelling place for you in heaven. I could go on for another half hour with that. And you could probably could too. He's done all of those things. And besides meditating on Israel's spiritual history or the history of the world and your history, how else can you cultivate that attitude of gratitude? Well, James says something just really, really incredible here in James 1:17. Every good act of giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father who made the heavenly lights. With him there is neither variation nor darkness caused by turning. Have you experienced any good thing in life, any blessing? Is there anybody here who could say you've never experienced anything good in your entire life? No blessing. Anybody? You've all experienced. How many of you experienced something good, some blessing? Somebody's love. How about a beautiful sunset? I just saw one Thursday night. A healing. How many of you experienced a healing? How many have had an insight, a revelation? How many have had a fresh understanding of the word? You couldn't understand something and it came finally. How many have had a creative solution to a problem you were facing? How many have ever received a gift that you loved? Yeah? A blessing. How many have ever had favor with someone? How many have experienced love? Peace. Joy. How many realize that your body, yourself, and your mind are a gift of God? That's what this is saying. They are gifts of God. Every good gift, every good thing you've experienced, are experiencing, and will experience, comes from the Lord. This was Diane's insight, actually. She shared this with me this week. She was saying, you don't have any excuse for not being thankful because everything good you've ever received is from the Lord. So what has to happen is we need to renew our minds and our ways of thinking. We have to set our wills to see the good things in our lives and the circumstances as coming from God. Because most of us are in the habit of thinking of, oh, that good thing, that was just a coincidence. Or that was something I deserved. I earned it. I was entitled to it. But all those good things in your life were the gifts of God. Now, God says his thoughts are not like our thoughts. He tells us in this verse, every good thing in your life is from him. So if you're not agreeing with that, you need to repent and renew. Ask God to renew your mind so that it will think like he thinks, seeing every good thing as coming from him. And we need to pray that he would discipline us, teach us, train us to be thankful. Not just for what he's done in our past, but this is key, but for his promises of the future. And I really believe this is the key to receiving those promises, to being able to wait patiently for them, to be able to continue pressing on toward his higher calling and toward your each individual promised land with that attitude, not of, well, I don't know if anything might happen, but with the attitude of, God's promised, I'm thankful, I thank you, Lord. Not praying over and over for it, but saying, I thank you, God, that that's going to happen. That's going to happen. That's going to happen. And even right here as a congregation, we could start by saying, we thank you, Lord. We're going to get that new building, right? And we thank you. We thank you that all Israel is going to be saved. Amen, right? So let's pray. So, Father, first we just come before you, and we repent. I repent, and my brothers and sisters repent of the attitude of entitlement, Lord God, that we deserve anything good, that we deserve the good things we've experienced. We repent of any disobedience to your commands, and we ask that we may demonstrate our love for you by our obedience, oh God. And we thank you for calling us to walk with you. I'm going to respond by saying, Hineni. Can you do that? That means, here am I. Let's say it together. Hineni, here am I, Lord. I want to walk with you. And Father, we thank you for all you've done in the past. Help me to remember it, Lord God. Thank you for all you are doing in the present, because things are going on. You are arranging things right now to fulfill things that you've promised in the future, but they're going on right now. And we thank you that you're working in the present. And thank you, God, for every good thing in my life. Can you agree with me for that? Thank you, Lord, for every good thing in my life. Lord, change our thinking to see that all the good that happens to me is from you. And may my faith grow, Lord, based on the way you've cared for me in the past and the promises of everything working for good, because I love you and I've answered your call on my life. And so, Father, now I ask that you would change how I pray. I ask this for all of us hearing this, that you would change how we pray, that we would begin to pray prayers of thanksgiving for the promises that you've made. We thank you for your promises personally and for each of us, that they will come to pass in this life or the next life. And we pray that you teach us to be thankful for the promises that you will fulfill in the future. We pray prayers of thanksgiving yet to be fulfilled. And Father, we thank you right now. How many of you have loved ones who are not walking with the Lord? Father, we thank you that it's your desire that all people be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And so we thank you that you are working in the lives of our loved ones. You are doing all that you can do, all that is supernaturally possible to bring them to you. And we thank you for that. We thank you that they will be saved, that there will be healings. Father, we thank you for the relationships that are broken that you will restore, because we prayed and you are a God of restoration. We thank you, Lord, for spouses yet to be identified in the lives of people who are single and are called to be married. We thank you for children yet to be conceived, oh God. We thank you, Father, for the salvation of all Israel. We thank you for seeing that come to pass in our own lifetimes and seeing it happen here in Rochester, the effect of that. We thank you for a greater moving of your Spirit here, Lord God, because we know you want to do that. And we thank you for that new building, Father, that is coming, because you've promised that you will make us a light in the community here. So we just commit these things to you, and we pray, Father, that you would just catch us when we start to pray, and we're praying over and over again for the same thing, and we would say, wait a minute, I already prayed for this. I need to just thank you for it, Lord, because you've heard me. You've heard me, and I'm going to stand. I'm going to manifest my faith by thanking you, oh God. And we just thank you for what we see in this today, in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670. or you can write us at 1326 North Whitten Road, Rochester, New York, 14609. Or visit our website at www.shemaiisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit a Fig Tree Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Israel. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Israel also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemaiisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.